Recorded Books presents Such Kindness by Andre Dubus III, narrated by the author. For Philip. Are those the faces of love, those pale irretrievables? Sylvia Plath. Some stars went out on me for good. Part from me, O sky. Wisława Szymborska. Part 1. Chapter 1. Our good Samaritan drives us through softly falling snow under street lamps that have come on early. The boy's car is filled with cigarette and pot smoke, and over the rap Jamie plays, he's just asked Trina a question. He looks over at her on the passenger side, his wispy beard dark in the dim smokiness of his rusted sedan. Trina shrugs and cracks the window and exhales smoke. Twice their age, I sit in the back seat. It's late in the afternoon, but already the lights are on inside the shops and restaurants we drive slowly past, both rear windows streaked with melted snow. Trina takes a deep drag off her cigarette, and she's laughing at something Jamie has just said. Behind the rapper's plaintive voice is a low percussion beat that sounds to me like bare hands on a joint compound bucket. It's almost 3 weeks from Thanksgiving, but hanging in the window of the bookstore is a Christmas wreath decorated with dozens of tiny paperbacks, and soon we're through the town center and into a neighborhood of big homes going back 200 years. Many are Greek Revival with gabled pediments and fluted columns painted white to look like marble. Years ago, as I became more committed to the building trade I somehow mastered, I started to read more about architecture and learned that back in the 1800s, banks were the first to adopt this look, choosing low gables supported by heavy cornices and wide trim to more closely resemble the temples of ancient Greece. Banks as temples. And now, like a ripped photo from a trip I never should have gone on, I can still see the glossy raised panel of Mike Andrews' office. It was walnut, Andrews' desk cherry, his tie a full Windsor, his cologne too strong, and he was probably just about my age at the time. Propped on the desk was a framed color photograph of him with his wife, both of them smiling into the sunshine with their ski goggles strapped to their flushed upper foreheads. I'd never gone skiing in my life. It was a sport for rich kids, kids I never knew, and in another time I might have felt put off by that image in this young banker's office. But that warm afternoon in late spring, 7,000 hard-earned dollars in my account, all of my taxes paid and up to date, I felt strangely one with him sitting across from me, just two guys climbing that ladder we're all called to climb, Mike Andrews just steadying its base for me with a generous loan. But ladders can get kicked over, especially when you're on one. And I had trusted him. That's the funniest part. I had trusted a bank. Jamie passes the joint back to me, but I shake my head no. I want to tell him to put it out and to be more careful, that nice towns like this are full of cops with nothing to do but look for beat-up cars like his that don't belong, but I don't say anything. Afternoon is turned to night, and we're passing the grounds of Phillips Academy. Under the falling snow, the windows of its old brick buildings are warm with lamplight, and I think of my son having gone to a school like that, a place dedicated to opening door after door for its students, most of whom come from families for whom doors are rarely closed anyway. Look at these fucking houses, you guys. Trina's voice sounds childlike, though she's 27 and has three kids. She's leaning forward in her seat, both hands on Jamie's dash, her cigarette glowing between two fingers. Jamie takes the turn and accelerates down a two-way that is already plowed, salted, and sanded, and the female voice on his phone comes in over the music and tells him to continue onto Jefferson Lane. The young rapper is still slapping the joint compound bucket in time, but now there's the low cry of a synthesizer, the boy singing in a falsetto about his girlfriend or his mother or both. Jamie says something about private property being theft. I ask him where he heard that Marxist bullshit. It's not bullshit, and it wasn't Karl Marx. It's some French anarchist dude. I just took a class. The female voice says to turn left onto Federal Drive, Mike and Carrie Andrews Street. It's a winding road through a stand of hardwoods that opens into a narrow lane lit every 40 to 60 feet by street lamps, snow falling past their LED bulbs, the sidewalk under them looking as bright and cold as the surface of the moon. But on this moon, stately houses are set way back from the street and hundreds of yards from each other. Most have floodlights embedded in the ground, lighting them up from below, and I can see right off that they're of the Federalist period, many of them brick with arched windows and heavy dental work under their copper gutters. Some even have round living rooms. Jamie's still talking about capitalism and social justice and the redistribution of wealth. I say, I used to own a nice home too, you know, and I worked hard as hell for it. There's nothing wrong with private property you work hard for. But we stole it from the Native Americans. Yeah, no shit. The female voice speaks through the rapper's falsetto, telling us that we have arrived. Jamie's saying something about boomers, and he pulls over to the curb and shuts off his lights. I'm looking across the snowy lawn at a Federalist painted white, the windows of the first floor lighted. And I'm about to tell the kid that his GPS has it wrong when Jamie says, "Is that it across the street?" "That's the biggest one, Tommy." And it is. The entire structure is canted to the east so that I'm seeing it through my water-streaked rear window at a three-quarter angle. But even its side is lit up from the ground by floodlights, and not for security. No, they're the floodlights of a stage. This house, the star. And now I recognize from Mike Andrews' Facebook photos the mortared fieldstone that makes up the exterior walls of the first floor. I recognize the bleached cedar shingles above that, their courses tight and narrow all the way up to the fascia in its Grecian key I hadn't noticed on my laptop before. But there are the tall, fluted columns on either side of the front door with its round port window matching the round, three-season porch that most likely opens to the pool and cabana out back. Under this porch is a three-car garage. Each of its doors a raised panel oak like the front door. I'm shaking my head. Have been shaking my head for a while now, my hand squeezing the back of Jamie's seat. That's it. That's them. Trina's door opens and the cold rushes in. She's running across the street in her hoodie and pajama bottoms and new white sneakers. I don't feel good seeing her do this. I feel the way I did so many times when I sent my young son Drew out into the cold to buy me a baggie of O's. Trina runs back to our car, slides in, and slams the door shut behind her. It has a lock on it. Who locks fucking mailboxes? Bankers, hun, I say. We just need to check their trash. I'll do it. It feels so strange to be hurrying across Mike Andrews Street under a lightly falling snow. A car's headlights sweep through the thin stand of hardwoods behind me, and I walk quickly onto Mike's white lawn and into the shadow of a cypress tree. The car slows as it passes Jamie's rusted sedan. It's an SUV, and as it passes the Andrews house, I can see through the back window of the car a movie screen hanging from its ceiling playing a cartoon for the kid or kids sitting in the back seat. Then I'm rushing behind Mike and Carrie Andrews' house. Wet flakes brush my face, and it's relief to see no vanity floodlights back here. But then motion-detecting security lamps come on and shine right on me. Set into the field stone of the first floor is a Palladian window 12 feet wide, and it's hard for me not to think of my own wall of windows overlooking the marsh. It's hard for me not to think of my one lovely acre of land and my homemade home, both taken from me. From here, standing exposed under bright lights, I can see Mike's daughter sitting in what looks like the kitchen's island. In her ear is a cordless bud, and she's eating something while staring at her laptop and then her phone. Soon she'll lift her head and see a man her father's age out in the backyard, his hands in the pockets of his Carhartt jacket, watching her. So I'm moving again, but now the fires rage along the pins of my broken hips and pelvis, and I ignore them and reach over the gate and unlatch the latch. I'm wheezing and already sweating under my clothes. The bolt sticks to my bare fingers and I have to yank it free, and now the gate is open behind me and I'm standing at the edge of Mike and Carrie Andrews' covered swimming pool. It's dark here. A car passes by out on Federal Drive and then another. It has to be close to 5 o'clock. Mothers and fathers coming home from work and school. Not the wisest time to be doing what I and my young friends are doing, but it's too late to stop now. On the south side of the covered pool is the cabana in that Facebook photo where Carrie Andrews sat with a glass of wine in her hand. Next to it is what looks like a pool house and maybe a tool shed, and I'm about to head in that direction when there comes the muffled groan of a garage door opening, and now light pours from a transom window high up in the wall supporting the round rec room, a light that falls on me and the covered pool, but also on 4 large trash barrels up against the garage's outside wall. The squeak of damp brake pads, an engine shutting off, then 2 voices, both of them male. I hurry out of the light and into the enclosure that holds the barrels. A car door slams, then another, and now the garage door is sliding back down its track. One of the voices rises in the notes of a question, and the other answers, Mike and his son Tyler. And of course Mike would pick him up first, probably from Phillips Academy a 30 miles away. His wife commutes to the city and back and so has the longer day, coming home each night spent from peddling other people's mortgages. Does that mean that Mike is the cook? Or is he one of those guys who order takeout? They can afford it. Or makes everybody pancakes for dinner? Or does he ask his 11-year-old daughter to cook? Or does he, like Drew and I used to do, prepare a meal with his son, one of them chopping the vegetables while the other pours olive oil in the pan? Once my wife Ronnie started graduate school, that's what I did. I was never much of a cook, but I looked up recipes online, simple ones made with pasta, and Drew and I learned together. Our favorite was a fast dish made with fettuccine, pistachios, and blue cheese, and my son's favorite part was crumbling up the cheese with his fingers. On the other side of the garage's wall, a door pulls shut and the transom light switches off, and I just stand there a second in the darker darkness. Why is it so much darker here than a few minutes ago? The motion sensing lights, they've gone off. Hip flames lick down my legs. I need to lie down soon, but why does Mike get to come home and be with his kids? My hands are cold. I rub them together, blow on them, then feel for the garbage can lids. I unlatch each barrel, then slide their tops down to the ground. I reach inside the first, but it's empty. Inside the second seem to be only plastic milk bottles and empty wine bottles, a lot of them. I picture Carrie coming home in an hour or two and pouring herself a glass the way Ronnie used to. The Ronnie would stop after one, and maybe Carrie just keeps going. In the third barrel are tied off plastic bags, and I pull out 2 of them. One feels heavy with decomposing food, but another feels lighter, drier, and I run my fingers along the outside of it and feel envelopes and papers. I'm tempted to check the 4th barrel, but it seems like I've been gone a long time from Jamie's rusted sedan. Mike might even be watching it right now from behind one of his mullioned windows. I reach for each plastic lid and latch them back into place. I grab the full trash bag and start for the open gate, but no, Mike could be in the kitchen, and those lights will go off, and then Mike will look out his grand Palladian to see what's what. The trash bag weighs no more than a gallon of milk, but still my right leg is on fire. Another car passes out front, and it's only a matter of time before someone on Federal Drive calls the cops on the stoner kids parked in this neighborhood they will never be invited to. Between the sunken garage and the pool house is an 8-foot fence with no opening anywhere. There's the faint sound of rap music, and I can only hope that this is coming from Mike's son's bedroom and not Jamie's car. My heart's beating somewhere above me, and I'm looking at the open pool gate in the snowy backyard, the light from Mike's kitchen casting warmly over it. There's just no other way. I'll have to keep low and close to the house, that's all, and I'll have to move fast. Carefully, I latch the gate behind me. I turn, and the yard has stayed lighted from the kitchen windows only. I lift the bag and clutch it to my chest. My fingers have gone numb. I press my left shoulder to the stone wall of the house, a design flourish that costs thousands of dollars just for the materials, not including the labor I happen to know. And now I and my flaming hips move one leg after the other so that my shoulder rubs along the cold stones. And as I get closer to the center of the house, I hear laughter inside, Mike's laughter. And then my knee bumps a hard metal corner, the bulkhead entrance to the basement. Muffled but clear comes Mike's daughter's voice, flabbergasted yet amused. "Dad, stop it!" "Oh, yeah?" Mike says. "What are you going to do about it?" Playful, having fun, and I picture him lightly snapping a dish towel in his daughter's direction or mussing her hair, and I don't know what I'm going to do about this obstacle at my knees, but there's only one thing I can do, which is to hug the trash more tightly to my chest, sit on the steel bulkhead, its surface dusted with snow, and try to shimmy across it without sliding to the ground. I'm just about to do this when two things happen. Trina whispers my name, and a bank of lights snap on her in the middle of the yard. Her face is an oval of startled flesh under her hoodie, her eyes squinting up at the white glare. Inside the house, the playful banter stops, and I'm sliding to my feet and running, Trina still standing there gazing up at Mike Andrews' massive kitchen window like what she sees on the other side is a show being put on just for her. The trash bag is bouncing against my leg, and I keep my face pointed to the dark woods at the edge of the yard, grab Trina's bare hand, and now we're running around the corner of Mike's house, me slipping nearly onto my side as we pass the cypress tree, the side security lights flashing on us, Jamie's headlights coming on as Trina jerks her hand from mine and runs across the asphalt lane and around the front of Jamie's car. Mike Andrews yells, "Hey!" And I yank the rear door open and toss in the trash bag, falling face first and wheezing onto Jamie's back seat. The door still open as the kid pulls away from the granite curb, Mike yelling, "I've called the police!" Chapter 2. On the sub shop's TV perched in the corner, the nightly news pans its cameras over skyscrapers bearing the president's name in gold letters 20 feet high. There are images of a congressional hearing of some kind, microphones in the face of a white politician from Louisiana. And there are the smells of fried steak and melted cheese, of sautéing peppers and onions, of French fries dripping from a basket. Trina and Jamie sit hip to hip across from me, and they seem suspended in a stoned, edgy radiance. Their faces are turned toward each other, and Jamie's wool cap is pulled back on his forehead. He's speaking low and fast, describing to Trina and me, like we weren't there ourselves, what the three of us have just done. And he's so proud that he didn't lose his cool and drove slowly back through all those rich neighborhoods until we hit the highway. Trina's face is flushed, and while I know that she's high, it's clear that this boy has mesmerized her beyond that somehow. In the flat, fluorescent light of this place, I take in his dark complexion and the smooth skin of his forehead, his black hair and curly black whiskers, his brown eyes glazed over by what he's been smoking all afternoon, his narrow shoulders and boyish voice. Because there's no way they're going to find us. Why do you say that? Behind my hip bones are glowing coals. I don't believe that Mike had time to call the police, but what about after? How much of Jamie's car had he seen? Because it was dark out and because my plate lights are busted. You sure about that? Yeah, it's a shitbox. Besides, all you took was some trash. Is that even a crime? I can't believe how big that fucking house was, you guys. How much do you think we'll get? Maybe nothing. That's a shitty attitude, Tommy. I need a cigarette. Trina smiles at Jamie. She has to be 8 or 9 years older than he is, but her entire face seems to soften, and now she glances over at me like I've just caught her in some private act. Jamie stands for her, and she scoots across the bench, and now she's outside leaning against his small, rusted car, smoking. The snow has stopped. Her shoulders hunch against the cold. Without her beside him, the boy seems even younger. He picks up our receipt and studies it. They call 36 yet? Can I trust you, Jamie? Of course. The boy says this before he even looks up. Then he does. Yeah, man, of course. Good. Behind Jamie, two men rise from their booth with their plastic trays and empty ketchup-streaked paper plates. They're both big men, like me, and they're dressed in fleece coats embroidered with the insignia of an HVAC company I hired once. One of the men nods at me as they pass. It's the tired, brotherly recognition one tradesman gives to another at the end of a long day. I become aware of my old Carhartt jacket over my atrophied shoulders, and I can't remember the man's name, but I know that he hung the ductwork for an addition I did in Swampscott not long before Mike's adjustable rate kicked in. The man probably thinks I'm just grabbing a quick dinner with one of the kids on my crew or maybe my own son, and this leaves me feeling both regretful and justified in what we've just done. Jamie glances out the window at Trina, who lifts her hand in a wave and blows out smoke. He smiles at her, then looks back at me. You can trust me, dude. Tom. Right. Jamie studies the receipt between his fingers, then pulls out his phone and studies that. When he paid for our food, I told him that I'd pay him back. My disability comes in soon. My EBT card not long after, though I have to sell it for cash for the liquid pain distractor I need right now. On the other side of the glass, Trina flicks her cigarette butt out into the parking lot, her eyes passing over both of us like we're not here at all. Then Jamie's standing for her so she can scoot over on the bench. There are the smells of damp hair and cold cotton and Marlboro lights. You should take it to your place, Tommy, and then I'll come over right after I feed my kids. It may just be trash, hon. Then we'll go get some more, right? Jamie looks from me to Trina, then back at me. A teenage girl behind the register calls out, 36, 36, your order is up. Half the girl's head is shaved, a dark tattoo on her scalp. It's the look of the apocalypse, the look of prisoners of war. And there's the nearly dizzying sense that I have just entered a more lawless world. Chapter 3. I have spent many hours contemplating pain. Its constant presence seems like such a dark joke, really. Like the school bully who sits on your chest and spits in your face years after both of you have moved on. My pelvis and hips were fractured years ago. Do they have to keep spitting in my face? It's close to 9 and I lie on plywood over the cushions of my couch in the 8. On the floor near my feet is the Andrews household's unopened trash bag. From here, I can see through the thin plastic the outlines of commercial-sized envelopes, a sheaf of papers, and what looks like a pencil. On the other side of the wall, there's only quiet. No yelling, no barely muffled video games, no fucking. All day and night, I hear through its concrete walls the muffled sounds of bad behavior. Trina yells at her babies. She calls them names. She swears at them. Sometimes her boyfriend Brian will be there, and he yells and swears at them all. Some got their units here in the 8 by lottery. Others because their family names were on the list for generations. I got mine through my former brother-in-law, Gerard, who was a boy when I married his older sister, a man who is now a lawyer and who, in an act of pity, secured me my own unit here in the 8. My neighbor Fitz drives a new Mustang. It's red with tinted windows, And when the inspectors come to check in on us, he hides it out behind the dumpsters filled with wet diapers and cigarette butts, with old TV sets and eggshells and used condoms, with plastic toys and empty bottles of wine. Fitz only pays me 75% the value of my EBT card. It's what I have to do so that I can buy the liquid pain distractor that keeps me from falling back to the O's. That and toilet paper, which I'm not allowed to put on my EBT card. After Fitz is cut, I'm left with only $100.38 for the month. And now Drew's birthday is in less than a week, though I have never stopped thinking of my son, ever. In the unit across the dirt yard from Trina's lives a young couple. He's black and she's white, and if I add their two ages together, I've still been on this earth 10 years longer. The woman's name starts with an A, Amber or Ashley, and she must have gotten pregnant in high school, and now they have 3 brown babies all under the age of 6. Those kids are always dressed in clean clothes, their hair and faces washed, 2 boys and a girl. Their mother doesn't let play with Trina's kids, who are not clean and who do not wear clean clothes. Trina's little one, Cody, 5 years old, looked at me one summer afternoon as I rose slowly from my Taurus, and he opened his little mouth and yelled, "Fucka!" In the next unit over lives an old woman. I believe she's close to 100. Every afternoon, a visiting nurse shows up in her blue Corolla. She spends an hour in there, then leaves. On Sundays, the old woman's son picks her up for church in his sedan. Its rear passenger door is covered by white letters in cursive, Bon Giovanni Shoe Repair. He's a big man like me, though he has 20 years on me and is clean-shaven, his bald head covered with a scally cap he takes off before stepping into his mother's unit. For the 1,000th time, I think that I do not belong here. I do not belong here with any of these people. In just a few days, my son will turn 20. But how am I going to get to his campus 100 miles west? All because I drove Trina to the lab to sell her plasma to make rent. It's something I do every week. But this time, a young cop in his parked cruiser took note of the expired decal on my rear plate. And now, sitting on the plank over 2 stacks of books I call a coffee table, are the 3 crumpled fines that may as well be loaded guns pointed at my head. One is for $607 for driving an unregistered vehicle. Another is for $530 for driving an uninsured vehicle. And the third, because I left my empty wallet back in my unit, is $500 for driving without a license. The tally pushes hotly through my head. $1,637. And this doesn't even include the cost of towing and storing my Taurus, the only thing that ever gets me away from here. Usually at sundown, I drive out to Cape Ann to see what used to be my home. I leave the 8 in this neighborhood of box houses like the one I grew up in, the vans and pickup trucks in their driveways, the strip plaza across the street with the liquor store and a salon called Don's Hair and Nails. I accelerate east for the highway overpass, a McDonald's on the other side, then a Napa auto store next to a home for old people, the front lawn just a strip of grass between the sidewalk and a parking lot that was always full. I think of my mother then, of the early dementia that has claimed her, of how I should visit her, but not till I'm back on my feet. A pathetic phrase, really, given how much pain I have to endure when I stand. Sometimes I turn onto the entrance ramp of the highway. I join the traffic of my fellow human beings and feel, for a few miles anyway, part of them again. A man coming home after a long day's work. A man who had every intention of carrying his own weight. I glance to my right and left, see women and men behind their wheels, some talking into their phones or driving quiet, their eyes on the road, on the spouses waiting for them at home, maybe, the hot meals, the happy kids. But other times, I stay on the back roads all the way to Cape Ann. It takes longer that way. I drive east past the gas station and sub shop. the movie theater and franchise restaurant with its Italian name and dim sconces. I pass the lawn and garden center, mulch piled in its lot in the summer, cords of split hardwood there in the winter. And how many times had I loaded my van with wood just like that? Then I and Drew, 7, 8, carried each log up to our rear porch where we'd stack it. And Drew would be in his wool Patriots cap, down coat and gloves, all of which his dad had been able to buy him. Soon I'm driving south through the salt marshes, thick stands of pines and birch between it and the grounds of Trevor's Academy. Driving by, I look out at its baseball diamond and lacrosse and soccer fields, the brick buildings of its campus built 100 years before the war between the states. It's where my Ronnie was raised by her historian father and her mathematician mother, two people I can't deny still loving, but also resenting. For while they did not make a materialist out of their daughter, they did raise an elitist, one I could never keep up with. No, that isn't fair, really. She's no elitist. She's an abundist. It's a word I made up, meaning one accustomed to abundance. She spent her girlhood in a brick house filled with books and the savory smells of her father's homemade soups and stews, her mother's ginger cookies and English teas. At night, when she was young, they took turns reading to her until she fell asleep under the thick blankets in a room decorated with framed paintings of landscapes and horses and the moon and stars she went on to study at Smith. For when she was a young girl, she and her little brother Gerard had eaten most of their meals in the Academy's dining hall with high school students who came from rich families up and down the East Coast, well-dressed teenagers who treated her and her little brother like their brilliant and adorable mascots. So that years later, when I first saw her at a house party off the UMass Amherst campus, there, in the kitchen doorway, stood a young woman with long brown hair spilling out of a cloche hat, an expectant joy in her pretty face that here was yet another room full of people who would like her just for being among them. No arrogance, just a deeply affirming relationship to the world I'd never witnessed or even considered possible. And then I was stepping toward her, a bottle of beer in each hand, her face turning toward mine with a question in her eyes, and I sure as hell hoped I had a good answer. What used to be our home sat in a grove of pine and cedar trees overlooking a marsh, and it was a miracle that it was ever ours at all. The land was part of a larger acreage I bought from a man who needed some fast cash and less taxable land, and sooner than I could even begin to believe my good luck, I was the owner of one precious acre with an open view of a saltwater marsh, and it had only cost me $90,000. That was all I should have borrowed. I had no business asking for any more than that. But when Ronnie first gazed out at that marsh, 2-year-old Drew beside us picking up a twig and throwing it, the air warm and smelling like pine needles in the ocean, the view so similar to what she was able to see every morning from the bedroom of her soft and billowy girlhood, that was that. I had to give her the rest of it. I wanted to give her the rest of it. And Mike Andrews was only too happy to lend me the kind of money I had no business even thinking of borrowing. Driving back to our former home, I parked just a few yards into my old driveway, then walked through the woods. Sometimes I pick up a long stick and use it as a cane, and there are the smells of pine in the sea, and I walk as far as the clearing, the very one I cleared, and I lean against a tree and stare at what I made. It's like watching an ex-lover dining with her new lover on the other side of a crowded room, her hair styled differently, the happiness in her face so apparent. The truth is, the new owners of my home took better care of it than I ever did. Once Ronnie and I and our son moved in, I never stopped working. The crash hadn't yet happened, and I still had more work than I could bid on, but meanwhile there came the winds and snows of winter, the spring rains, the summer heat, then fall with all those leaves and pine needles filling our gutters, one of them bent by an ice dam one bad February. The clapboards needed staining, and the corner boards and window trim needed paint, and some of the long deck boards at the rear of the house had begun to split, even though I was careful to pre-drill every galvanized nail I drove. I just needed to take a weekend and start to go at it all, or get a week between jobs when I could do it. But there was no week between jobs. And on weekends, if I wasn't doing paperwork for a current project or calculating numbers for the next, then I was visiting Ronnie's parents, Wynn and Nancy, with Ronnie and Drew, or hosting dinner for some of my wife's new friends from her graduate school or the dance studio where she took classes. Or I took my son with me to tune up my van or get a hamburger somewhere, just the two of us, father and son. And then the adjustable rate Mike Andrews had winked at me about kicked in, and our monthly mortgage seemed to nearly double itself, and all I did was work and worry and work some more. And then the wheels fell from the gaming tables coast to coast, and I took my three-story fall, and here I am on one of my escapes from the eight, leaning against a tree or stick or both, taking in all the improvements the new owners have made. They painted the corner boards a handsome sage, the clapboards coffee brown. They replaced the bent gutter with one that matched the trim, and not only are there no more dead leaves and pine needles on the roof, it's now thick cedar shingles nailed over my sheathing and my rafters, making everything look not only more aesthetically pleasing, but like the true owners of this house had finally moved in. I place my empty cup on the plank table, then slowly stand. Day after tomorrow, my son will turn 20, and it's highly unlikely that his father will be there, isn't it? Because even if I do open this stolen trash at my feet, and even if I do find something I can cash against the banker's accounts, will this really happen in time for me to get my car registered, then free it from Kelly's towing and storage, which is costing me $50 a day, and then drive the 2 hours west? And I have no idea what Drew is doing right this minute. I don't know what courses he's taking or what his class schedule is. I don't even know how many roommates my son lives with off campus or if he's living with his girlfriend. I know so very little about this boy who slipped between my fingers like the baggie of O's I seemed to trade him in for. I set Mike and Carrie Andrews' trash bag on my formica table and rip it open. Loose papers and envelopes and an empty Starbucks cup spill onto my tabletop and roll to the floor. I put on my readers. I wish I had better light to work under. The first thing I pick up is a greeting card, the cover a sparkling champagne flute. The word congratulations floats above in a cloud of white streamers. I'm about to set it aside, but I open it and see handwritten words by Mike himself. My one and only KA, Senior VP, you deserve this, honey. You can see by these tickets that we'll be celebrating across the pond, so brush up on your French, mon amour. Love, your proud hubby, Mikey. Mikey? K.A.? Across the pond? I study the date in the upper corner, 10 days ago. Did they already take that trip? A long weekend, maybe? I picture Mike and Carrie strolling along the Seine holding hands, and I toss the card onto the floor. I reach into the bag for the rest of the trash, but most of it is shredded paper, mounds of it. I scoop all of the trash out onto the table. Half of what lies in front of me are shredded balls of paper. I pick up a handful and study it, but each strand is no wider than an eighth of an inch, and I can make out little. I pick up an unopened letter to Mrs. Michael Andrews, junk mail from a car insurance agency in Ohio. There's more mail for Mrs. Michael Andrews, or Carrie Andrews, and this bag is clearly from her office, which means they each have their own office, and mine was always the kitchen table, Ronnie's the couch where she'd do her homework on a lap desk she'd bought from a catalog. Carrie gets a lot of catalogs. For kitchenware and clothes, for jewelry and ski equipment, for shoes and spa treatments, and one for lingerie from some designer with a Greek name. There are catalogs for wine and sailing, and there's one from Louis Vuitton with a page marked with a sticky note. I open to that page and see, circled in red ink, a small handbag called a croisette. It has a shoulder strap and a gold clasp, and it costs $1,650 for a fucking handbag, and she circled it? I gather up all the catalogs and dump them onto the floor. The plastic lid of the Starbucks cup pops off, a smudge of lipstick around its tiny hole. Part of me thinks I should feel guilty about what I'm doing, looking for blank checks sent to the Andrews by their credit card companies, convenience checks that can be cashed for the full line of credit. But I don't, because all I'm planning to take is just enough to get my car back, to go see my son, to maybe give Trina a helping hand while I'm at it. Mike should consider himself lucky, though this is not a word I've ever believed in. In this world, you make your own luck, and you do it with hard, honest work. Honest work. From my laptop research, I found out that Carrie Andrews works in the secondary mortgage market, that she's employed by an office in Boston that bundles up all those precarious loans that men like her husband peddle to working people like me, Tom Lowe Jr. Banks have been doing this for years, I learned. Because if they don't sell their mortgages to investors who then collect interest on them, then only the biggest banks would have enough freed up money to keep lending. But the trouble came when all those sold mortgages began to be pooled together and sold to other investors as securitized bonds. These were then given AAA ratings by the same agencies paid to do just that by the makers of these very bonds and other securities. It'd be as if I wrote checks to the building inspectors entrusted with making sure that my house frames were built to code. How could I expect these inspectors not to approve my work? And yet all those bundled house loans were riddled with debts that could only be defaulted on, and so I, like millions of other fools, got subprimed. I got subprimed because Mike Andrews, with his affable smile and relaxed athletic demeanor, could see just how hungry I was to build and own my first house. Not just the first for my young family, but my first ever. What do you think you make in a good year, Tom? My best was last year. 70, 80,000? 64. Let's call it 72, shall we? Mike smiled and winked. And that would put your monthly fixed number at... Andrews tapped away at his calculator. I knew there was no such thing as a fixed anything in my kind of work, but I remember a calmness opening up inside of me, the rare feeling that someone was actually trying to take care of me. It was the one thing I couldn't quite get used to with Ronnie, her love for me. A few nights before applying for that loan, I sat at the kitchen table after dinner writing down the price of finish work for a kitchen in Hamilton, and she came up behind me and began to rub my shoulders and neck, her fingers smelling like tomatoes and rosemary. I started to pull away, but she leaned in close and whispered, "You need to let me love you, honey." Under the mound of shredded paper is an empty Tums dispenser, an Orbit gum wrapper, a bent green paperclip. I pick up the sheaf of papers, but they're nothing but blank sheets of printer paper stuck together from what looks like a large red wine spill along its edges. There are a few other unopened business envelopes, but it's all automatic mail from charities or more insurance companies and a BMW dealership, but none from a credit card company or bank, and what else did I expect? Of course Carrie and her husband would use shredders. Of course, they'd never throw out anything that could be used against them. Still, I pick up the shredded mound and run my fingers through it, the way I used to with Drew's hair when I was looking for ticks. In the middle of the mound is something round and plastic, and I pull out an empty prescription bottle. Its cap is off. I turn the label toward me. It's written out to Carrie Andrews, Celexa, 20 milligrams once a day. Celexa? I make my way back to my plywood couch, open my computer, type in the name of that drug, and soon learn that lovely Carrie Andrews suffers from anxiety or depression or both. I read the list of side effects. Later tonight, Carrie Andrews may be lying awake with Celexa-induced insomnia right beside snoring Mike. She might be nauseated or sweating or suffering from a dry mouth or quote-unquote sexual side effects, which don't get specific, though it can't be good, and that's probably the real reason Mike bought them tickets to Europe. He and his KA needed a boost of romance. I shut my computer and stare at Carrie Andrews' trash. I start to feel a rising joy at the thought of some real discomfort, pain even, going on inside the Andrews home. But I can't deny that also rising inside me is a disappointing recognition of their humanity, that even bright, shining lives like theirs cannot evade some kind of trouble. But I'm seeing again the big glowing houses of Federal Drive and their big private lots. I'm seeing Mike Andrews' massive Palladian window set into field stone, Mike's modern kitchen under recessed lights on the other side, his well-dressed, well-fed daughter on her computer and phone, the covered pool and automatic garage doors under a round rec room that probably holds more furniture in it than I've ever owned. A $1,650 handbag? A trip across the pond? No, we are not in this together. And while yes, it's probably true that Mike and Carrie work hard at what they do 5 days a week, it's not an honest living. Honest. My face warms with shame. I have never stolen from anyone before. All my life, I've been a man who works. But after my car was towed away, Trina and I had to walk home from the lab in the rain. She'd pulled the hoodie of her sweatshirt over her head, but it was soaked. So were her shoulders and the hems of her Jimmy Neutron pajamas. Pierced into her right ear were a silver cross and a blue star, small and dull-looking. And as we walked along, my hips flaring, she put her thumb out, then pulled the hoodie off her head, her hair so drenched that her face was all one's eyes were drawn to, her cheekbones, her nearly full lips, her eyeliner running along the sides of her nose. Almost immediately, a car slowed and a bearded kid rose up out of it, our good Samaritan, Jamie. "You guys need a ride?" The inside of his car was warm and smelled like cannabis. The back seat where I sat was covered with political science and engineering textbooks, and hanging from the rearview mirror was a locket holding a photo of a golden retriever. Jamie told us his name and asked where we were going. "Amesbury?" Trina turned to him then. She tucked a wet strand of hair behind her ear. She smiled and said, "Can you take us there? I gotta get home to my kids." It was quite masterful how she said this, really. Her tone was almost playful, like she might have had some sort of sweet reward for him if he'd only do what she asked. But the word kids canceled the possibility of that sweet reward while also assuring him of her maturity and ability to follow through, all while she stared at him with pale blue eyes and a wet face. Then we were pulling up to the 8. Our identical two-story units covered with vinyl siding the color of a public toilet. Weeds poked through cracks in the asphalt lot, and the concrete steps leading up to my stoop were out of level, their risers also cracked. Jimmy wrote on a slip of paper what looked like his phone number, and Trina told him that she didn't own a phone. "How can you live without a phone?" She shrugged. "You get used to it." But she took his number from him anyway and was already at her own door before I moved, the hems of her pajama bottoms sticking to her shoes. And yes, it was her idea to steal someone's credit card information. The screws holding my hips together may as well be heated steel. I rise slowly and take the white plastic bag, and then I get down on one knee and push into the bag all the crap from Carrie's office from the past week. All of Carrie's catalogs, her shredded mounds, her red wine spill along the edge of a sheath of good paper, her empty Tums container and prescription bottle. Tommy? Trina walks in the way she always does because I never lock my door. Her eyes have cleared and she's in a thin blue robe, her feet in untied sneakers. Her long hair is wet and combed. She jerks her head in the direction of Carrie Andrews' trash bag. Haven't you opened that yet?
I have.
And?
Nothing. It's all shredded.
Fuck!
Trina.
What?
I'm no thief.
Are you sure there's nothing in there? Let me look.
Go ahead.
It doesn't take her long, her back to me, but after she sets the catalogs and mounds of shredded paper to the side, Trina opens every envelope of junk mail, rifling through pages she's not taking the time to read, looking for anything, I guess, with dollar signs on it.
Trina?
Who rips up their fucking mail?
Trina?
What?
She turns toward me.
Her robe is open slightly, the skin of her sternum pale above her cleavage. She pulls it closed.
I need that money, Tom.
I can only nod. Ringing through my head is Mike Andrews' raised and slightly rattled voice. I call the police.
It felt good to rattle Mike. It felt good to know that he might have gotten just a taste of what it's like to be preyed on, just a little.
Get a job. I'll watch your kids. Though I don't mean this, and I know it.
Right.
If I don't work under the table, my fucking rent goes up. And how are you going to watch my kids? You're useless. I'm getting that money, Tommy.
She moves so fast by me that she ruffles the air. There are the scents of hair conditioner and washed cotton, and I think of the dirty laundry, including some of mine, that she carries a half mile to the CVS plaza where there's a laundromat, its big machines taking quarters earned from her own plasma. The morning my car was towed, Trina was nervous. Drunk the day before, she had her boyfriend ink a new tattoo halfway between her navel and pubic bone, even though she knew that plasma sellers like her have to wait 6 months after getting a tattoo before they can go back to the blood-separating machine at Mavern Medical. She stood there in my unit, just feet from where I lay on my plywood couch, and she was wearing the Jimmy Neutron pajamas she lives in, her T-shirt tight against her breasts and waist. She drew deep on her cigarette and blew smoke out the side of her mouth. Then she told me how her boyfriend Brian, with his shaved head and tattooed neck, etched into her a heart broken in two. You know, down low. I wasn't going to ask her where or how low. But before I could say anything, she hooked her thumb behind the waistband of her pajama bottoms, then pulled them and her underwear down until there it was, a red broken heart on a red patch of skin above a rim of dark pubic hair. It was like glimpsing the bright crack of your own future, and you couldn't say whether it was blessed or cursed, only that my breath lay still in my chest, and I said, "Oh, Trina, they'll only see that if you show them." She must have known what she was doing because she kept her thumb hooked in her pajama bottoms and underwear, pink, blue, a second longer, her eyes on mine in almost a mournful way. Then she let them both snap back into place, and now my hip fires are burning. I need my pain distractor, and I need it now.
Chapter 4. In the narrow kitchen, I pull my jacket off the hook and head outside into a softly falling rain. The air is cold and smells like the overflowing garbage cans in my tiny backyard because it's a rare day when I can make the trip to the 8's dumpsters without having to rest and cool the fires.
even when I use the kitty wagon Trina found for me. I wait for a car to pass wetly by in the street, and I'm aware that my work boots are untied, and I have no idea of the time, though the lights are still up in Dawn's hair and nails. Near the window, a young woman is teasing the hair of a much older woman, talking into the mirror. Through the plate glass window of the liquor store, I can see the owner Larry is not working, which won't be good for me. Instead, it's Larry's son-in-law, Paul, a gum-chewing 30-something-year-old in a camo sweatshirt. And as I walk in, his eyes are already on me like I came in to shoplift. "Evening," I say. Over the stereo speakers come the warmly combative voices of men talking sports. Larry, a quiet man who has owned this shop, he told me, for over 20 years, plays classical music when he's working the register. It's rising violins, often making me feel like the world is a mystery and I've left it behind. And then I'm setting onto the worn counter the cheapest bottle of vodka they sell. Paul's eyes are on my whiskers, my old open Carhartt, my T-shirt hanging out under my sweater. I say, "How are you today?" It's the upbeat tone I use whenever I know I look the way I do, like I'm a degenerate and not a man with an education and the skills to build this store, the counter between us, the floor Paul stands on. He rings up the vodka without a word. I hand him a 20, and Larry's son-in-law drops 2 pennies into my open palm, which I drop into the plastic cup, holding dozens more. It's a minuscule act of generosity even I can afford, but Larry's son-in-law's eyes are on me like I'm an empty fire extinguisher. I grab my vodka bottle by its neck, then I'm crossing the street under a cold rain, my sockless feet damp and slippery in my old work boots. What the vodka does, its liquid burn trickling down my throat, is make my hip fires feel like less of a problem. It's like that story I read in one of my colleges of those British and German soldiers declaring their own truce on the dawn of Christmas morning, 1914. Slowly, they emerged from their opposing trenches and drifted into the gray waste between them, and there they traded smokes and plum pudding and even sang carols together before the sun set and they were called back to the violence that was their duty. I rest my glass on the plank beside my couch. I put on my reading glasses. Sitting on my belly is my open laptop with its screensaver image of Ronnie holding Drew as an infant. This was in our apartment before I built the house. Our baby son had just breastfed, his tiny body swaddled in white, and Ronnie's shirt was unbuttoned, her long hair pulled up in an untamed bun. She wasn't wearing any makeup, which I preferred, and I walked into the room on tiptoe, holding the camera to my eye and saying, "Hey," just before I pressed the button to Ronnie raising her face to me, her eyes lit by a dark and deep and nearly secret love. Off to the left of my ex-wife and baby son are the 3 blue folder icons of my research, big pharma, insurance, banks. I open my browser and tap my way to Craigslist. I haven't used it since the months of our foreclosure when I sold whatever we owned that I could. Our couches and upholstered chairs, our dining room set and guest room bed and bureaus, the oak bench in the foyer, almost everything but my tools, which I still hoped to be able to use again one day. What a time that was. What a lovely time. I spent most of it on my back, high on whatever my doctors kept prescribing me, my 10-year-old Drew bringing me peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, or my urinal bottle, or the mail that I didn't even open anymore. Ronnie had set up my rented adjustable bed in the living room so that I could be near the downstairs bathroom in the kitchen, and so that I could look through the wall of windows out at the woods and the marsh, the sun setting into it every night like an unrelenting statement of some kind. For a few months after my accident and the surgeries, we lived off the little Ronnie was beginning to earn, and we borrowed from Ronnie's mother and father, two people who'd managed to be comfortable without ever having much. Their home had always belonged to Trevor's academy, and while they owned a camp on a lake in New Hampshire, Ronnie said she would rather lose everything than ask them to sell that. She was standing a few feet from my bed when she said this. She was still dressed in her work clothes, a blouse, light sweater, and black rayon pants. Drew was in the kitchen doing his homework at the small island, its granite top a forest green with deep charcoal veins running through it. I drove 100 miles into Vermont for that slab, and I made it long enough to seat six, the hope being that we might still have more kids to fill our expensive house on the marsh. Ronnie was sharing a small office in Essex where she saw her clients, a word I found odd for a therapist to use. It made me think of customers for advertising executives, not the women, men, and teenagers my wife met with for 50 minutes at a time, 6 a day, 4 days a week. Before she went to graduate school, her degree at Smith had been in astronomy with a psychology minor, something she added because her friends kept telling her what a good listener she was. And she found that she enjoyed studying human beings even more than she did the cosmos. That she was ultimately far more curious about people, though throughout our first weeks and months together, I only seemed to notice how curious she was about me. Why do you drive a van? Because I'm a carpenter. Why are you a carpenter? Because I'm good at it. Do you like doing it? I like creating things, yes. Did you always want to do that? No. Why are you in college? Because I don't know. What? We were lying in my bed together. It was in an apartment I rented with two other students, both younger than I was by 10 years, like her. It was winter, maybe morning, maybe afternoon. A hard sunlight shone across the foot of my bed and her bare foot sticking out of the blanket. I lay on my back and she was on her side, her body warm beside me. And now she moved and rested her leg over both of mine. I mean, do you want to do something else? I must, I laughed. This is my fifth college. And I told her of having gone to 2 community colleges and now 3 state schools, of having enough credits for 2 bachelor's degrees, though I hadn't earned 1 yet. No, what I earned was debt. Why do you think you never finished? Nobody had ever asked me that before. I don't know. Work kept getting in the way, and what? I guess I never really felt like I belonged in those places. She was quiet a moment. She ran 1 finger in a light circle over my chest. Maybe you just want to go farther than your parents went. This hadn't occurred to me. I didn't think much about my mother and father, or at least I didn't think I did. What had occurred to me, though, is that I never felt as if I really belonged to the people I came from. I was raised on a dead-end street in a box of a house covered with asphalt siding. From the TV room, I could look through a thin stand of pines and see the northbound lanes of the state highway. My mother was 15 when I was born, 17 when my little brother Charlie came along, 24 when our father, Tom Lowe Sr., died of a heart defect while driving a forklift in the warehouse that swallowed him. Ronnie, she was so different from all that. I tap my way to my emails and type in her name, her responses to me appearing in a short stack from the most recent one I sent her to the first written 6 years ago when I'd been living in the 8 less than a week. I was newly clean and still on the Suboxone, but I spent a lot of time on my couch staring at the sloppily sheetrock ceiling of my new subsidized life, some young woman on the other side of the wall swearing at her kids, an idling Mustang outside blasting rap. I kept picturing my wife and son in Edward Joseph Flynn's historic home on Salem Common, my own home sold off to who knows who. And I snatched open my computer and wrote to my soon-to-be ex-wife, "You should have just killed me. Hope you're fucking happy." Hours later, she wrote back, "Tom, I'm not proud of how I ended things with us. And you know I tried to save our family, but I couldn't save you, Tom. And I had Drew to think of. And when I was given a second chance, I suppose I just took it. You can't blame me or anyone else for what happened, Tom. And can't you see how privileged you are? You're an educated white American male. No one is more free on this planet than someone like you. I know you can't do carpentry work anymore, but stop feeling sorry for yourself, Tom. Do it for Drew." Veronica. "Which is why I need to sell the only valuable things I have left, all the tools in the basement of my unit. They took me years and years to collect, buying one or two at a time, but only when I needed them. And I see my former brother-in-law Gerard and his pained expression the last time I saw him when he and his workout buddy, another corporate lawyer, set aside a Saturday afternoon for a little corporate altruism and hauled my tools to the 8. The truth is, I should have sold them all years ago, but if I had, it would be like selling the last of my once-toned muscles, my genitals, my very bones, broken or not, my brain and hands that, together, still knew how to do so much constructive good. But instead of selling them, was I really going to be a thief?" I tapped my way to classifieds.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.